again, discerning between good and evil, and this is the lesson following last week's, where we talked about overcoming sin, and we discussed basically four things: realizing God's help to change our desires, limit our opportunities, to help us to exercise self-control, and to reduce sin from time to time, to seek forgiveness from that sin. So those are the four major points that we talked about last week. But it does beg a question, and that is, what is sin? And to answer the question, just very simply, precisely, sin is missing the mark. The mark is God, God's word, God's will for us. And if we miss that, either it would be because we do something we should not do, or we don't do something that we should do. In missing that mark, we disappoint God, we sin against God. And sometimes it is difficult for us to know what that is and what that is not. It has led to an awful lot of error in the world. Religions, when they deal with these issues, because it takes some diligence in our part, some study in our part, a lot of people have the idea that there's no way that we can know God's will, which is a ludicrous thing. So, because God revealed his will to us. And it does not make sense that God would reveal his will in such a way as to not be understood, or us not be capable of understanding it. And God has created us. He created us for the express purpose of doing his will voluntarily. That is, as a part of free will. So the two points that are well established in Scripture indicate that God has told us what he wants us to do. He expects us good, and we are capable of knowing that will. But it's not something that just comes to us automatically. It's not something that that we receive some knowledge or some discernment without effort. That is work on our part. Help from others sometimes, if we ourselves are insufficient in our knowledge, will be helpful. But those kinds of things are things that are talked about in this particular lesson. So the first point in the introduction that we want to remind you of is in Hebrews chapter 5 and verse 12, and that is knowing that first major thing, that it's not something that comes merely through just a simple assimilation. It is something that takes effort on our part. Hebrews chapter 5, it says you need someone to teach you again the first principles and the oracles of God, and you come to need milk and not solid food. And he says this need for someone to come again and teach you is because you have not progressed on your own. Everyone who takes only of milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. The solid food belongs to those who are full age, that is, those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. And that's where we get the title of the lesson of this evening, discerning between good and evil. You notice it takes an exercise of our senses, it takes diligence on our part, it takes receiving or learning the will of God. Not only the will of the Word, but also the need of the Word, as indicated in the context. So it does take some effort on our part, and that's the purpose of the lesson, to supply some instruction on how best to do that, ways in which you can gain some ability to discern between good and evil so that we can have that closer walk with God and pleasing all things. So, just going through these points, the first one is the simple one, and that is, if you go to God's Word and you find that God or the Holy Spirit or the Apostles writing through the influence of the Holy Spirit, if it is said, you don't do this, it's something that is condemned by God clearly, then you don't do it. And there are many things. But the simple ones, maybe we can emphasize and illustrate the point is, for example, murder. Murdering someone is unlawful in the sight of God. It's not only wrong in the sight of men, but God says it is wrong as well. Murderers are not on the list that will lead to life, but rather their names are among those who will spend eternity in condemnation. There are other things that are equally clear. Adulterers, fornicators, those who are lewd, those who are lascivious, those who gossip, those who hate, those who go on, including something as simple as lying, that we might think is not a real big thing, but it is in the eyes of God. evil for us to condemn something when an individual has no choice in the matter. You've heard all the arguments that are made these days. But then they want to look for God. They will find a church that is willing to set aside what the Bible has to say about homosexuality or about being in an adulterous marriage or living together or any of those kinds of things that we can talk about. We can also be talking about various addictions and those kinds of things. All the immorality that we see in the world today, there is almost always, if not always, a church, quote, that will be accepting of someone because they will say, we'll accept you as you are instead of accepting as God does for an individual to be converted in order to be accepted by him. And so there are a lot of people that reject it, but it isn't because it is unclear. I just read a simple list that clearly states that there are some things that will lead you to condemnation. And there's the same thing mentioned in Ephesians 5 from 3 to 7, fornication, all uncleanness, covetousness, filthiness, foolish talking, coarse jesting, fornication, uncleanness. No covetous man who is an idolater has any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and God. And no one deceive you with empty words, but because of these things, the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. Therefore, do not be partakers with them. Now, we do express the caveat, which probably does not need to be said, but occasionally we bring it up so that people understand, especially if we're studying or talking with individuals who do not have this full understanding. We're not talking about an individual losing their soul if they do something like this one time, or in a moment of weakness, they fall for a good sin. We're talking about unrepented sin, unforgiven sin by God because the individual persists rebelliously against his will in doing these kinds of things. And in fact, there are many Christians in the first century who were like that at one point. And such were some of you. But you have been changed. And there is a change that comes of becoming a Christian. And for us to have that closer walk with God, that walk of discipleship, is something that's changing our lives as well. So that's the first major point that he makes here. Is it clearly condemned in the Bible? If it's clearly condemned in the Bible, you can rationalize all you want. It doesn't change the fact that God says don't. And God says it's wrong. And God says that those who do so will suffer as a result of it. So that's point number one. You might have any questions or comments with regard to the points made so far. Alright, then we get into the second point here. And this one has a little bit more nuance to it. But it is legitimate. And that is it sin? drunk, but as Peter indicated in his epistle, there are times when it is any less than that, and yet it's still condemned by God, the banquets and other things. And so here on this occasion, he makes the note that if we talk about drunkenness, can we not talk about an individual who becomes inebriated by the use of marijuana or some other drug rather than alcohol? And it is like alcohol. Now, when we say it's like it, we say it's not the same thing. The highs may be somewhat different. The problems that are associated may be somewhat different. We're not trying to say that they're exactly the same. But what I find is very interesting is that in the Christian world in general, over the last several decades, and maybe 7 or 8 decades, I don't know how far back it's gone, but there has become more and more acceptance of a moderate use of alcohol, and yet the condemnation, straight out condemnation by individuals who themselves will drink, and perhaps do come slightly or fully inebriated because of the drink, and yet they condemn marijuana. And there's one argument that they use about this, which you hear time and time again. And that argument is that marijuana is against the law, and alcohol is not. But, of course, alcohol was against the law as well during the temperance movement. The time of prohibition didn't stop people from doing those things that were illegal. I just recently read a study with regard to the legalization of marijuana in many states. There were some argument as to whether it is legitimately working or not, that it has allowed more and more to buy marijuana legally, and that there is an increase in the trade with regard to illicit drugs still. It hasn't gotten rid of those. And then there was this one part of the state, 37%, I think, of the individuals who were used in this survey said that if it became unlawful in their state, words, if there was a reenactment, a rolling back of the law that there once again coming unlawful, that would not stop them, that they would continue to partake of marijuana and to smoke. So, with regard to this idea of legality, I have very little doubt that it will become legal, and already is in many ways usable and legal in many states and on the internet and those kinds of things to use it. And then that argument's gone. But other than that distinction between legal or not legal, I should put it very clearly, a young person who smokes marijuana is not doing anything that is more disgusting, evil, dangerous, sinful than an individual who is drinking alcohol, because that inebriation is sinful in most cases. So amyloid is used, and that's the example that he uses under point A in number 2. What about smoking marijuana? Is it not like drunkenness? And a way to contrast this, as he indicates in point B, is by looking in that same chapter, Galatians 5. Because along with the list of verses 19 through 21 of Galatians 5, which is the lust of the flesh, there is a second list given in verses 22 and 23, the fruit of the Spirit. So these derive their origin from the Holy Spirit. They are love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. So if you look at those things, if you contrast them with the list of the lust of the flesh, and which has this list of evil things and the like. So the question is, and I think the Apostle Paul does this very well in Philippians chapter 4, talking about meditating 4:8, about those things that are good and noble and trustworthy that are good or poor. We have to make a decision as God's people as we seek to have successful lives of discipleship. What's going to characterize our lives? What are we going to act like? What like things are going to be characteristic of us every day? And in so doing, if we emphasize that, as is related in the text of Galatians chapter 5, as we let the fruit of the Spirit gain control and preeminence in our lives, we will not fulfill the lusts of the flesh. And yet we see again a lot of Christians, and I remember Dick Hatch standing off to the side and some of sometimes do something that God doesn't want me to do. I'll ask God to forgive me if I need to, but it's not that big of a thing. I remember talking with one individual. We were discussing an issue with a man and his wife, and talking about physical abuse, and to be honest, he was about ready to punch him out because of physical abuse. But I also mentioned the fact that he was a prolific pornographer as well. And that was another issue that his wife had with him. He didn't bring that up, he didn't know. And just the way people are sometimes. But, you know, if you're going to hit your wife, if you want to look at porn on the internet all the time, well, that's something that's different. And so we have our own views sometimes about what's bad and what's the worst and where the line is. But the Bible very clearly teaches it. And the good thing is, he teaches us how to avoid that. And one of the good ways of doing that is by making that contrast. And the like, stay away from those things just as you stay away from the things themselves that are listed in the list. Okay? All right, questions, comments? Yes, Chris.
You talk about focusing on where that line is. There's an aspect of that in discernment. Discernment is, you know, implies there's a line. But if our mind is focused on the line, how close am I on one side or the other? You know, it makes me think of, you know, the kind of language of Hebrews 11. That's by definition looking backwards and not forwards. And the other thing is just the way that the way that we work. If we're focusing on that, if you think you're close to the line, the reality is you're probably already over. It's just the way our minds work.
That's a good point. And that's something that I, as a preacher, I've come across an awful lot from when I was very young until now, where someone wants, they come up to me and they'll say, where does he say I can't? And that's their focus, is the things that they want to do. And they're going to do them unless you can supply exactly where the line is and tell them that this crosses over and you convince them, which is sometimes hard to convince someone like that. But in reality, the wisest and the most spiritually minded of Christians, the ones that you have the most respect for and you trust the most, you don't have to worry about that because they never get close to it. And you might say, okay, the line's right there, but they're not going to get close to that line, and they're not worried about the line because they basically disciplined themselves and determined through discernment that they know where that line is, and that's way where they want to be. And, of course, that's what the cat is trying to establish, too. They were trying to get too close to the line, as far away from it as possible can. And that's the more mature and the better way of looking at it. So, yeah, there are lines. God has drawn lines. But it's not one of those things where God is going to just be okay at all the time until the line. And everything will be okay if you step over the line sometimes, or it's not going to be a big deal in that kind of stuff. This is sin that we're talking about. These are evil things. God's faithful devotion to us. So we've got to have a different mindset with regard to this information. Yes, please.
Just an example, it's impossible. If you would think about it and consider the fact, it is impossible to guide the speaker. You either guide below it, or you will be above it. You try to guide the speed limit, you're always going to end up speeding. You have to stay away from that line. You have to stay underneath it.
That's a good point to make. The best of human intentions, there's a good chance that you done the 56 instead of 55, 41 instead of 41, and you're going to be able to get close to the point. That's just an obvious thing.
I'm just thinking the Bible teaches us to flee, not to be opposed.
Good idea. Now, there's another thing, it's an interesting point to make, which is the thought that you're in mind, and that is the idea of conscience. Because in Romans 14, and 1 Corinthians chapter 8 and 9, and other places, which actually aren't any of the ones, the passages that are dealt with in this particular text, but it is an interesting point that there are certain things that some people can do and others can't without being guilty of sin. And those things are not inherently sinful, but the violation of one's own conscience can lead to sin. I said it doesn't really come recommend anything in this passage. Romans 14 does in verse 23, which kind of introduces that thought. In Romans chapter 14, as it deals with the eating of meats and observance of days and such. In verse 23 of the text, we are told that he who doubts and is eating meat is condemned as he eats, or if he eats, because he does not eat from faith. So I try to explain this. Sometimes I do a better job than I do one other time. But just to put it as simply as I can, if a man thinks that God condemns him eating meat, and he eats it anyway, the reality is God doesn't condemn the eating meat, but he will be upset at that man, angered at that man, for being guilty of transgression because that man thought he disobeyed God and did it anyway. And so that's the key here. It will violate your conscience. And so we are told that we are doubt, or we are condemned if we doubt. And let everyone live according to the dictates of his conscience. And I remember defining this just recently. I don't remember what to say anymore. But the ego, G-I-G-O, garbage in, garbage out concept. The conscience being a moral computer is possible for any wrong data in. And so what comes out, how do you feel about it? If I feel like it's all right for me to, let's say, to drink till I'm blind, or completely inebriated, that there's absolutely nothing wrong with it. And I think that way because I've been told that way since I'm very young. I've been around with people who are that way, all those kind of things. There's nothing sinful about it. Then I'm not going to have any shame when I do that. It's not going to be ashamed of it because it's just normal. It's every day, everybody does it, or other people do it, and it doesn't bother me at all. But if I'm told from the time that I'm very young that such use of alcohol is sinful, and then I do it anyway, then I'm going to feel ashamed because my conscience told me, hey, that's wrong. And yet I ignored my conscience, and I did it anyway. So what I was doing was violating what I thought God felt on that, what my faith was in that matter. And that's why there were two individuals in Romans 14, one who could observe the day and one who could not. God didn't care if he observed the day or not. Inherently, it wasn't even sinful about it. But one man thought it sinful, and he did it anyway, so he violated his conscience and sin. The other man wasn't sinning by doing it because he knew it was all bad. The same thing with you and me. So those are the concepts that are found with regard to it. And so that's something you have to come into view about as well. We are told again and again and again in Scripture, and he mentions three passages right here in 1 Timothy chapter 1 and 3. In 1:5, the purpose of the commandment is love from a pure heart, from a good conscience. So this is what God expects for us, to have a good conscience and sincere faith. Verse 18, this charge I commit to you, O son Timothy, according to the prophecies previously made concerning you, that by them you may wage the good warfare, having faith and a good conscience. So that's what, again, Paul is expressing is necessary. And then in 1 Timothy chapter 3, with regard to the qualifications of deacons in verses 8 and 9, he says that deacons must be reverent, not double-tongued, not given to wine, not greedy for money, holding the mystery of the faith with a pure conscience. And so the idea of a good conscience, a clean conscience, a pure conscience, there are all kinds of consciences that are mentioned in Scripture. You can just see by the language that's used, the adjectives that are used, as whether it's a good one or a bad one. But a seared conscience, for example, as is indicated in 1 Timothy chapter 4, the Spirit expressly says that in latter times some will depart from the faith and be deep to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared with a hot iron. There are weak consciences, there are violated consciences, and there isn't the one where it's a seared conscience, which is basically the little voice in your head that doesn't sound anymore. Doesn't make any noise at all, so you just do it. You used to, you knew it was wrong, and it upset you. And it got a little easier, a little less upset. But finally, you do it now, it doesn't bother you at all because you're a seared conscience. And that is a possibility as well. So, we need to have a good conscience. Now, the way we can get a good conscience is we always listen to how we feel. The still small voice, and the feelings conscience is only infallible if it's taught correctly. So the second thing about having a good conscience is by studying and knowing what it is that is right and what it is that isn't wrong, and then listen to the voice of conscience. Okay, so that's my, I love to preach on the conscience. So we're working up again and again. So there may be a little repetitive there, but it's important for that. So anyone have any questions or comments about conscience? All right, then that gets us then to the fourth point of the evening, another bell, and that is seeking counsel. The question is, what do mature Christians say about it? And I want to note that this is important for each and every one of us. We have had calls to preach on this in the past, and we've emphasized that young Christians need to listen to the hoary head, the gray hair, individuals that they trust, and they know have wisdom and discernment because they've earned it, they've worked hard at it, they know things that you don't know. But truly, I think each and every one of us can find individuals who have been around long enough, who have exercised themselves sufficiently to where they may have good advice or something to say about what is troubling us. And so we're all, not a single one of us, that are outside of that help. But it is especially important for young adults, young teenagers, young children, I'll say young adults tonight because teenagers and children are not infants, but that you respect and listen to what the mature Christians say about what you're thinking. And too often, that isn't done the way that it should be done. Now, he does have a caveat here from point A, and that is that's not the ultimate determining factor, because, of course, even a mature Christian can be wrong. And I'll tell you something, when a mature Christian says he can't be wrong, then I don't know if I would trust what he has to say, because it sounds like maybe he doesn't have the maturity he thinks he has. We all recognize that we can understand God's word imperfectly. We can be first to admit it if we have wisdom at all. The fact is that some know more than others. And there are opportunities to ask the advice of other individuals. That's one of the reasons I think why elders exist, and they are to be in every church. Qualifications are of such to have when men show themselves and they prove themselves to be worthy of that position. They should be elevated in that position so that their wisdom and their counsel has some significance in the minds of others. You don't have to talk to an elder to get some help, but the elder's help and counsel often has a little bit more sway to it because of the position he holds. And because of who he is. But the advice of mature Christians can always be helpful. Paul in Philippians 3 and verse 7 told them to follow his example, but also, he said, to note those who so walk, as you have us as a pattern. So Paul basically said himself, as rightly as an apostle and as an inspired man, as an authority, but he said, also look at other people who are trying to live like I live and try and follow the example. That's a very good thing to do. Now, I will go in 1 Corinthians 12 and 20. Does anyone have anything more to add to that? In the text of 1 Corinthians chapter 12, you're familiar with. This was at the death of Solomon when you have King Rehoboam taking his place, but there was unrest. And what happened during the time of Solomon, you remember, it was a rich king, and there was heavy taxation, there was the filling of the king's coffers and those kinds of things, and some wise older men came to Rehoboam and they said, basically, if you make things a bit easier on the people, they'll like it a lot. And then he went and he talked to some young men the same age as him, and they told him, they said, no, you say if my dad was hard on you, I'm going to be harder, and you just tax him more, and you be stricter with them, and you, I guess they were saying, show who you are, follow each your place, play hardball with them. And of course, Jeroboam's rebellion was successful, and as a result of this, there were 10 tribes that left and established the northern kingdom of Israel. Jeroboam basically lost a good portion of his land and to develop a relationship with someone and provide a future. And I think that's simply wrong. It's good to develop a relationship, but Paul's his success was never dependent upon becoming friends with someone. So it's always good to be what you can to all men, but it's never good to compromise with the whole gospel at this time, future time. And I'm not saying that I even think that Mark would do that or does do that, but it's just there's some teaching there that I thought would be really clear in that matter. But having said that, influence is important. The wife can influence her husband, as found in 1 Peter 3 and verses 1 and 2. And we need to be willing to be a good influence on others. Not always what you say, sometimes what you do. But it is important. And so that would be a good thing. Would I be a good influence? Would I be a bad influence on others if I did this? And you can tell whether it's right or wrong. That you are asking the question. Then question, our point number 6 is, of course, stewardship. The apostle Paul indicated that it is required in stewards that they be found faithful. We don't have time to read Matthew 25, which is the parable of the talents, but here indicating that God expects for us to take what he has given us and utilize it. And if we don't utilize it, then we can be guilty by not doing what God expects. And so he says here, we need to be stewards of our time, money, and bodies. We're not good stewards. Some activities that may be harmless in themselves, but they require a lot of time and energy, may keep us from doing what God expects or doing what God expects. And life of that discernment. Okay? And then finally, we get to the last point number 7, that is, would Jesus do? What would Jesus do? I confess the fact that wearing the jewelry is a little bit problematic in my mind, because again, it happens so often that there are people who would wear what would Jesus do, WWJD, and then they do things that Jesus would never do, or they don't understand what that actual determination entails. And so, when we look in Luke chapter 6 and verse 40, Jesus himself said, a disciple is not above his teacher, but everyone who is perfectly trained will be like his teacher. That's what we must do. We must be like Jesus. And so that's a question we can ask ourselves. Did Jesus do it? I want to know whether it's good or bad. Did Jesus get involved in it? Did Jesus do it? And that's an important question for us to ask ourselves, which is why we need to be studying Jesus. Why such an important thing that we know how those things are.
And when we think about our discernment, we need to be discerning about our own discernment, because you know, we can look at Jesus. There were things that he did that people accused him of being a poor steward, of his time with Mary and Martha, of money with the costly oil. You know, there were things that he did that those who considered themselves conservative, the Pharisees who, you know, set up rules so that they would never get close to the line, that they pointed at Jesus and said, healing on the Sabbath, that crosses a line. And in each of those cases, what it really drives home is that if everything comes back to the Word. When Jesus was approached on those times, it was, you know, you haven't been discerning about the Word. And so, you know, that there is the danger that we can sometimes get into of we read the Word, we get our impression of the Word, we don't go back to the Word, and we live the rest of our life with our impression of the Word and all these things, but we don't keep going back to the Word. And it's very important through all these things to, that is the ultimate arbiter, is the Word. It's not, you know, it all goes back to that. It's not our impression, it's not our rules, it's the Word. And hopefully, as we're going through our life, we're making sure all these other things are built on the Word, not just our impression.
Yeah, that's a good point. I hope that we've emphasized that in our study, just from the very first point. All of this is specifically on what God's will says for us. And keeping our head in books, or in the book, would be very beneficial in making the right decisions on this. And of course, when the book tells us we can depend upon this, and this will help, and that will help, and we'll certainly utilize those things. But ultimately, Christian and good works,